Okay, so now regression, now recording has been started. What is the multiple regression? There is a cause, there are factors. So there is a cause, there is a result. So basically, multiple regression, some people also say causal relationship between dependent and independent variables. Dependent variables like your income. Your income depends on many factors like your education, work experience, your side business. So there are many factors on which your income is based. Similarly, house price in any area depends on different factors, area per square feet rate, or you know, area locality, and many other factors. So multiple regression is the one using which you can predict many things. But you know, for that you have to make a model, regression model. So we are going to learn today how we can make regression model, and is that a valid model or not. So these things we are going to check today. Is there any question? So this is my, you know, data that I just normally demonstrate. So this is the data. It has 500 values, or you can say I have 500 records. And basically this data is about chance of admission. This is the chance of admission of overseas students, particularly Indian students in USA. As you know, approximately 1.2 or 1.3 million students are in. So let me write this so that you can better understand. So the problem is that there are 1.3 million approximately international students are in USA, out of which every year approximately 300,000 students get in USA for pursuing higher studies, out of which, or you know, out of 300,000, almost 22,000, I would say, to 25,000, roughly, I can say, Indian students get into USA universities. The admission depends on various factors, and you know, some of them are for GPA, or you can say in India it is called CGPA, your GRE score, your English score, your statement of purpose. You know, a student has to write one statement why he wants to pursue education in USA, what is the purpose, and basically it's a self-written statement. Letter of recommendation, you know, basically those letters are normally written by their ex-professors or ex, you know, someone who is, you know, teacher or boss. So letter of recommendation. And it also depends on what kind of university he is going in. Is it research university or our teaching university. So basically, our Eastern Washington is mostly teaching universities. However, it depends on these two factors, and also depends on what kind of university he is applying. Let's say 1-star university rating. So 1-star to 5-star. So these are the factors that we have right here. So every year, 22,000 students get into US. Now, I would like to know what are the chances of admission if my GPA is 9, if my GRE is this much, TOEFL is this much, statement of purpose, letter of recommendation, or these factors, if I, you know, understand, I would like to know what are the chances of admission in particular university. So this is, I have to make a model. So what I do, I go and randomly 500 Indian students data collected. So this is what I did. Now let me do the modeling based on this data, how I can start. So very first thing is, let's go here. Can you see this? So this is, just a minute. So I hope you can see my data now. This data is about the same situation. Here is the chance of admission, and here these are GRE score, TOEFL, university rating, statement of purpose, letter of recommendation, CGPA, research. These are the, so now first thing, you need to understand which is dependent variable, dependent, and which is independent. So basically these are independent variable, this is dependent. So this is the, these are the causes, and this is the result. So let me go here. First thing, the correlation. What is the correlation? Relationship among, or relationship between variables. So I go here, state, basic statistics. Here I have correlation option. I have clearly explained in the slides, which are right here, you know. So first thing, how you can go on correlation, regression. This is the alternative way of using regression. Here you have simple regression, you have multiple regression. Here you can see correlation. What is the correlation, hypothesis? Null hypothesis or rho equal to zero. And alternative hypothesis is rho not equal to zero. Decision by default in Minitab, it takes 5% level of significance. Calculate R and P value, and you can reject or accept the null hypothesis. So these slides are, very systematically made, so you can refer. Now let's go here. I'm going to do the correlation. So I go here, statistics. Under statistics, basic statistics. Under basic statistics, one, here we have. Now I need to see all independent variable, and I'm just selecting all of them. Here we have the option, which is called pairwise correlation. So this is important, because once you make this, then only you will get the p-value. Otherwise, p-value will not appear. So you just check it. Here you have, by default, it is 95%, but you can select as per your question, as per your requirement. Now I just, these are the matrix, these are the plots made together in one, but we can't understand this GRE, TOEFL. Here you can, so this is cross matrix. Now, this is important for us. This is, you know, so this is a graphical display and this is a numeric display. So these are the correlation. So what is the correlation between TOEFL and GRE? TOEFL and GRE is 82.7%. 82.7% relationship is there between TOEFL and GRE. A statement, so you can see all of them. These are they significant or not? We can see here. So for example, TOEFL and this is first pair. So these are the all pairwise comparison. So first pair is TOEFL score and GRE score. N equal to 500, correlation is 82.7%. What is the p-value? P-value is zero. That means, so as we have the null hypothesis, rho is the, this is H, zero, and alternative is rho is not zero. That means what? So this is rho. This is not zero. That means what? If p value is greater than alpha significance level, then we accept the null hypothesis. And this is the null hypothesis. So if we have more than, you know, the value is more than 5%, then we can say this correlation is zero. However, it is less than 5, then it is not zero. Means this is correct. Are you with me? So all these which are, you know, less than zero, less than 5%, they are all not zero. All null hypotheses are rejected and alternative are accepted. So here you can see all of them are, you know, perfect pairwise. So this is the correlation, this is the p value. So first thing first, there is a correlation which is all not zero and we identified. Now the second thing is about, let's go after this, let's go into the regression part. So I stat. Here we have regression, and what we are going to do, we are going to choose the option which is fit regression model. So here under regression, fit regression model, I'm going to use this. Now here, what is the response variable? Chance of admission. What is the, you know, serial number is not, you know, important, GRE 2. This is the continuous predictor. So I'm just going to, here is the one thing, categorical predictor. So basically research, this is research university, you can say, or not research university. So these are the two categories, isn't it? Two categories. And we can basically put this value here in categorical. Similarly, the university rating is also different category, 1-star university, 2-star university, 3-star university, and 5-star university. These are also categorical. So these are categorical, as you know, the continuous categorical predictor and continuous. So, but you know, I'm just going to put everything right here. So I selected all, they are all here. I'm not going further here, but you know, there are options that you can choose the confidence level here or significance level here. You know, this is coding, we are not graph here. Graph, you know, basically you can say normal probability plot of residual versus fit, residual versus, and I will let you know the importance of all of them later. And here we have, here is store. So I have to residual, standardized residual. So these things you can store. Now let me go over this. Now we got our regression model. The model is, if you have any question, you can always ask me in between. Chance of admission is equal to minus 1.276 plus this GRE plus TOEFL plus this much plus what are the values ahead of, you know, the research. So basically, let me show you what are the these, you know, numbers before 1.27 or 8 or this or that. So basically, if you plot, I'm just going to show two dimension. So for example, if this is, let's say, chance of admission, and this is, let's say, GPA or CGPA. And if you plot this line between chance of admission and CGPA, this is simple regression example I'm showing. And suppose this is the line. So this part, this is called intercept. This is called, so basically this is intercept in regression model. And for example, if I do slope, if I get to know the slope of this line, let's say I'm going to put 2 points here, one is here, one is here, any 2 point on the slope. And I'm going to take, you know, vertical or horizontal line up to y-axis and the x-axis. So this difference is called the y difference or del y, you know, in mathematics it is written. This difference from here to here is known as del x or difference of x. So slope equal to del y by so these things, you know, for example, CGPA is this part, you know, can you see this is a slope, but this explanation is just, you know, when one dependent variable is there, one independent variable is there. When there are multiple, it is like, you know, best fit line. So basically we can't imagine, we can't understand by two dimension, we can imagine, you know, how it would be best fit. So this is just, so these are the slopes, these you can say, and this is intercept. Now, next thing about this. Okay, so this is, now it's very simple. If suppose I know this is the model has been made. Now I want to predict if, what is my chance of admission if I score this. So I go under statistics, regression, and here you can see the predict, option predict. Let's say my GRE score is out of, let's say, 328. TOEFL score is like 118. University rating is, let's say, 4. Statement of purpose is 4.2. Letter of recommendation 3.8. And CGPA is 9.5. Research, let's say, it's keep. It research for one. So this is what are the, no, based on this model, I'm trying to see my chance of admission. Okay, let's see, this is all. So here, what is the chance of admission here? 90.5%. How much chance is there? 90.5%. Standard error, confidence interval, prediction interval with 5%, you know, or for 95 confidence, it would be between 78% to 100% with 5%. And this is the predicted value. So based on this model, we can do the prediction. Now let's go back into the model. We made the model, but are we going to check the is model valid? So now the question comes, is model valid? We are going to check the validity of the model. So this is the model. These are the coefficient. Let's see what are the values of the coefficient. Are coefficient valid? Means are this intercept or intercept or these slopes are valid? Let's say here constant, which is minus, this is intercept. Now the here null hypothesis is this. I'm just going to show you one or two. Beta or beta zero. Beta zero is normally equal to zero. And this beta zero is intercept. This is the normal equation that if you remember, y equal to v zero plus b beta one x. So plus beta two x two and keep going on. So this is alternative hypothesis says beta zero not equal to zero. Similarly, you know, another hypothesis for slope beta one equal to zero and alternative is beta one not equal to. So keep writing all similarly. So based on that, now look into that constant minus. So what is the other interpretation of this? Useless. Useless constant in the model. And this is, you can say, useful. And I will demonstrate this to you. Similarly, beta zero means useless and beta one, H1 is useful. So now look into that. The same constant, first constant. Okay, this is the t value. What do you, it is useful or useless? Since the value of alpha by default, it is 95%. This is useful or useless?
Useful.
Very good. This is useful. Means in this equation, chance of this is useful. What about ZRE?
Useful.
Exactly. This is also useful. What about this TOEFL?
Same.
Exactly. Now come on to university rating. This is, we are
useless.
Useless. Okay, this is useless. I'm just putting this. A statement of purpose, this is also useless. And rest are useful. Okay. Now, what is the interpretation of this? The interpretation of this, that university rating, if you remove this, means this part doesn't have any significant contribution in chance of admission. And similarly, a statement of purpose. So these two items are not important, you know, in predicting the chance of admission. And let's say how it is. So what means you can put them zero, you can remove them in the equation. So let me do this same thing. Statistics, basic statistics, regression, predict. So earlier I predicted, you know, using these numbers. Now I'm going to put exactly the same numbers. And let's see, I'm just going to put zero value against SOP, against university rating. So TOEFL score is exactly same. University rating, since useless, I'm just going to put zero. Statement purpose is also useless. I'm going to put zero. letter of recommendation, I'm going to put exactly same value. CGPA, I'm going to use the same. Only these two, because these are useless, doesn't impact my results, my equation. So let me do. So I'm going to predict two students' profile or two students, you know, chances of admission where university rating is zero and the statement of purpose is zero and other has. Let's look into that. So look into, this is the first case. This is the first case where these are the numbers. What are the chance for this student is 90. We already looked into 90.5%. Same thing is happening here. I put university rating and statement of purpose. What are the chances of admission? 87.4%, which is how much? Almost 3% less than if we don't have these two. If a student doesn't have any university rating option or, you know, the statement, it doesn't affect his or her admission into US universities. With confidence here, 74.94, here 78% and 200%, here 99.9% with confidence. That means these two, as per statistics, these two variables are not that useful. So this is the first thing about coefficients. I'm going on to next part. So how you can interpret? This is the interpretation. Okay, for example, if you change the significance level up to what? Even 90% university, you have to do like 92% confidence, 88%, then university rating might be, you know, will be useful. However, the statement of purpose is altogether useless because 72%, which is very high. So in any admission, this is concluding that statement of purpose doesn't play any role. Means if you write about your own why you want to take the admission in any university, statement purpose, I can take liberty, I can write, you know, free flow, whatever I want, that is not significant. Now go to the model summary. This is error part. This is R square is the coefficient of determination, or it's called regression coefficient of determination. This is most important. What is the interpretation of this? 82.19%, 82.19% chance of admission depends on following factor. Means chance of admission depends on 82% chance of admission depend on GRE, TOEFL, university's statement, or in other words, you can say 82% cause on chance of admission due to these factors, or, you know, 82% chance of admission can be explained by GRE, TOEFL and all these things. Means you can frame your sentence in different way. So this is the meaning of 82.19%. What is adjusted R square? Adjusted R square is the one when you remove these two values, which is this and a statement of purpose. These two values, if you remove, then without these, you know, it is only considering the variable to calculate R, where, you know, these insignificant or useless items or useless variables are excluded. So these when you remove these variables or you don't count in your regression, and when you see the R square, that is R square, adjusted R square. So this is, you know, when you see any regression model, R square is always higher than adjusted R square, because R square includes everything, And R square adjusted include only useful items in regression model. Okay. Is it making sense? Now let me go bottom. Here, analysis of variance. So this is overall regression model. This is overall regression model. What is the meaning of this? The meaning of this, again, this is overall regression model is useful because it is less than significance level. So overall regression model is useful. You know, these are again the same thing, the constant. These are, now let me go. Fits and so look into the numbers. So out of 500 observation that I have, fits and unusual or observation, maybe these observations are creating a problem. For example, observation number 10. Here, observation number 10 is a problem. Observation number 53 is a problem. Observation means you don't have data or you have to clean in order to get better results. So for example, let me go on to observation number 10. Where is it? 10. Okay. Look into that. He has GRE score 323. TOEFL score is 108. And you can see his GPA is 8 points and chance of admission is just 45%. That means this, you know, or probably the reason is that the person who gave his data might be made a mistake, or you might made mistake in order to record the data. He has something, or, you know, so basically this observation is not correct because this is, let's say, observation number 53. Here's a 53. Here is the, he has GRE score this much, TOEFL score is this much, university rating this much, but his chance of admission is only 7 points. GPA is also lower because kind of, you know, GRE and TOEFL is very high. I mean, TOEFL is out of 120, he has 116. You know, this is I think 350 is GRE, out of he has 3, but you know, the GPA or studies, so, and chance of admission, so probably this is against the, similarly you can see, either you can clean these data if you really want, or you can go to those people and you know, Mr. 59 is Mr. XYZ, you can go again, approach them, and you can confirm whether your data is correct or your data is not correct. And if he says correct, probably you might need to exclude. If you, you know, out of 500, if you exclude these things, hopefully you will get better results. So this is the first thing. So this is the, you know, output that we get out of regression model is this. This is the meaning of all the things. Now let me go further. So correlation, I think I already explained. Main So this is the regression process that you have to follow in order to do assignment, eyeball test, steps, normality conditions is this much, n is equal to greater than and equal to 30. So, which you already, standardized residual, individual plots, residual versus fits. Now let me go to, so this is regression model. And now let me go. Now, another thing is about multicollinearity. So let me explain about the multicollinearity. Multicollinearity. That is another big issue when you do regression model. What is this? Means occurs when independent variables, X, Y, or, you know, in our model, we have GPA, CGPA, and all, are intercorrelated, means they are highly intercorrelated instead of being independent. And that is there, if person is highly, you know, intelligent, then certainly his GPA will be high, his TOEFL or, you know, GRE will be high. So that is called multicollinearity, and that is what is the biggest problem in order to predict or modeling any regression equation. So collinearity, if only two predictors are correlated. So, and the degree of multicollinearity is high concern or real concern in any model. So look into that, and it is, you can visualize the multicollinearity in this manner. Here, this is your Y. Y is your, you know, dependent variable. X1 is independent. These are the three independent way. And they are all together, you know, they are all separate. They are not intercorrelated. Look into the, in this case, here, X1 is, fine. Where X1, X2, and X3, they are overlapped. They are highly correlated. Here, in this case, VIF will be here. In this case, when they are all not correlated, the VIF will be 1, 1, 1. What is VIF? Variance inflation factor. And that, you know, that is the indicator of checking the multicollinearity. Here, in this case, VIF is 1. However, X1 and X2 or X2 or X3 will be higher than 10. Higher than 10 or lower than. So now the third thing here, you can see the, if all three are there, they are, then VIF is higher. So let's look into the situation, and we have some thumb rule that you have to follow. Here is the, if VIF is 1, no variance inflation. If VIF is 2, mild variance inflation. So practically, when we do this, we have to keep the eye that it should not be more than 2. It can be up to 2 or little bit up to 2. Then 10 is a strong variance and 100 is severe variance. So basically, what ideal is 1. Ideal is 1. And 2 or little bit close to 2, we can consider, but not more than that. And this is, so there is no limit of the magnitude of VIF. VIF 10 says that other predictor explain 90% of variation in predictor J. So this is the highly and serious, and most of the things are here. So I'm just going to show our output. Let's look into that. So can you see, can you check which is the VIF that is serious concern? So here we don't have any only research is the one. And I can say letter of recommendation is another. Only two VIF are as per our multicollinearity. However, other GRE, TOEFL, university rating, SOP, they are intercorrelated. You know, they are dependent on each other. You know, they are correlated. If, you know, I'm highly intelligent, I'm very studious student, certainly my GRE will be high, certainly my CGPA will be high, and therefore, and TOEFL will be high, and then you can see they are intercorrelated, and there's no doubt that. So basically, however, no VIF is 10, no VIF is more than 5. there are some researchers who also predict, you know, this this should be up to 5, and less than 5 we can consider up to this. So, but you know, we are going using our book up to 2 or close to 2. This is 2.03 we can consider, but rest of them, they are highly intercorrelated in this situation. So this is about, now look into that. This is residual and this is standard residual, and this is normality plot. Is this, you know, what residual are normally distributed or not? We have to check this. So I'm just going how we can check graph. And here I have probability plot, and this is, I can do multiple. I'm just going to do one by one. Let me see, this is residual and this is standard residual. Or let me do one standard residual. I don't need to do anything. You can see p-value is less than 5%. What is the meaning of this? This, you can see this is not, you know, this is not normally distributed. So here is the another hypothesis I'm going to go over a little bit later. So this is not, let me see the residual. It's a graph, a probability plot, and residual. This is also not. What is the residual? Let me demonstrate. Let's say this is your regression line, you know, this, these are the, you know, points that you plot. And let's say this is your best fit line or regression line. That this difference from here to here, this difference, you know, these are called residual. And look into the, they can be either positive or negative if you see. Similarly, if residual can be converted into a standardized residual, you know what is the standardized? The formula is Z equal to, remember, X minus mu upon sigma. This is a standardized. So if you convert everything into that, you can get the standardized residual. And you know, we want to see all the these, you know, residuals have the probability plot, normal probability, or they don't have normality. So here it is not coming normality. The, so let me go over the slide if I miss something. So the step one, identify here. The second thing, assumption here. The another thing is, this is the, these are the two rules. Evans rule, Duane's rules. N divided by K must be greater than 0. At least, that means at least 10 observations per predictor must be there. So if you are going to do prediction, at least 10 observations per a predictor must be there. Let's say I have here 500 observations about each predictor. Duane rules, this is our book author. He has, you know, relaxed version, and he said at least 5 observations per predictor must be there. So I would say, you know, have, you know, this is when you have at least sufficient data, then only you do the regression modeling. Don't do for just, you know, you have only 2 pupils data or 2 observation or 3 observation or 4 observation and you are going to do modeling. No, as large as the data, better the regression model or better the model, because it, you know the reason, because we reaches to the normality. So you can see the scatter plot of everything. Here is the regression stat. So this I already explained. Model validity, p-value, that means if p-value is less than 0.5 means not normal. Here, for example, in this case, it is not. So this I already explained. useful? Is it, you know, these constant are useful or not useful? Multicollinearity I already explained. So this is about multicollinearity. That rest, you know, when you do the correct problems. So unusual observations. So if you have these unusual observations, like I showed you some of the, what you need to do, just go fix the data, clean the data, or just, you know, go to the respondent or check your, you know, is there any data in problem in order to enter in the, you know, table or something. So basically fix the data, check with the respondents or other things. So these are, for example, correct problems, reduce variables. So suppose, you know, there is high in, you know, collinearity, you can reduce some variables. Let's say two variables of CGPA and GRE highly correlated. You can remove one of them and probably you can have. So interpret. So these I already explained to you in, you know, these, what is the R square, you know, what is the S. So what is the S value here in model? This is means the typical deviation between predicted and actual birth rate would be 5.287. So in our model, so this is a standard error. That means this is the interpretation. Predict, you can predict, you know, simply I already showed you how to predict it. So this is a predicted predicted confidence. This is predicted confidence interval, predicted interval. This is confidence interval. And there are three assumptions. The errors are normally distributed or not. We can see, you know, by plotting. The errors have constant variance, that is homostatic. The third is the errors are independent. They are not autocorrelated. So assumption third is normally applicable in the time series data. When you do the time series prediction, time series for regression, then only this is applicable. And there we use Darwin-Watson test. So let's look into that. So H0 errors are normally distributed, H1 errors are not normally. And we have plotted, here and our, you know, significance level is 5% and the values are less than 5% in both the, so errors are not normally distributed. We can clearly find this. Here errors have constant variance, here errors have no constant variance. So how we can see, I'm going to show this. Basically, here is the, if you see the error, this is residual versus, if you have funnel in, funnel out kind of plot, you can say non-constant variance. So if you see this kind of situation, this is non-constant variance. Autocorrelation, this is errors are non-autocorrelated and errors are autocorrelated. So this is the third thing, and here we use Darwin-Watson test. So here we go, DW. If Darwin-Watson test is greater than, less than 2, suggest positive autocorrelation. If Darwin-Watson test is greater than 2, suggest negative autocorrelation. So let me demonstrate these things in our. So I go here again, I do statistics. Regression, fit regression model. And I'm just going to model. I have all these things, options. I'm not changing, coding. I'm not doing anything. Step-wise, not doing anything. Here, no graph. Here we have the options of 4-in-1. You can have this also, or you can have all these in. So I'm just going results. Here you can see Darwin-Watson test. Can you see Darwin-Watson under results. So I'm just clicking this. I'm going to, you know, standardize residual or residual. So here you can see for, so basically, okay. And let's do. So let me go with, where is Durbin-Watson test? Here you can see the Durbin-Watson test is result is here, which is less than two, less than two. What is the meaning of that? Less than two means positive autocorrelation. However, Durbin-Watson test is only useful when you use time series data, when you have the time data. You will see the time data where, you know, one independent variable is related to time and second independent variable related to, you know, like this. So you have time series data, then autocorrelation is important. And where am I? Yes. So this is the situation. Now let's look into the graphs. Can you see this is the, can you see this is funnel in, funnel out situation? This is probably funnel in situation. When you see overall, you can say, then what you can say here, non-constant variation is there. So this is the second assumption. So three assumptions are there that, you know, we check. Errors are normally distributed, errors have constant variance, and errors are independent. Now, let me go over again. Here, I'm going to tell you, instead of doing all this, you can check, cross-check your knowledge. Go on assistant. Here is the assistant. You use regression. Here you have two options, simple regression, when you have one dependent, one independent variable. Here you have two variable, multiple regression. Response variable, what is the chance of admission? What are the continuous productor, GRE? I'm just going to use, you have to be careful which is categorical variable, which is non-categorical. So I'm not inputting any here, I'm just counting them all. But you have to, whenever you are doing in real life means practical life, you have to be careful in order to choose dependent and independent and categorical variable, continuous and categorical. I'm just minimum number of columns one, maximum number of columns are five. So here they have maximum number of column five here. So I'm just going to do five only, and then which is most important. So I don't have, you know, I don't need a statement of purpose. I don't need research because research is categorical, or I can use research later on. And what is other thing? University rating. Okay. Okay. Two. Three, four, five, and then I can use here university rating. Okay, sorry, I can use. So basically, I look into this. This is multiple regression, chance of admission. Here you can see the variable, the following terms are in fitted equation that models the relationship between y and x variable. x1 to x4 are these things. And if the model fits the data well, the equation can be used. So here they also write some commentary. Look into the percent of variance explained. This is the VIF. What is the VIF? We have multicollinearity, 80% variance. Percent of variance explained by the model, 80.82. So basically this is R square value. R square is 80.82, means 80% variation in chance of admission can be explained by these values. Here you can see this assumption. This is funnel out, funnel in. That means you can see, so basically unequal variance is this. So you can see this is unequal variance situation. Now, here you have, you know, other things that you can understand. So basically this is another option in order to do regression modeling. So any question related to regression, please let me know. I tried my best in order to explain in 1 hour, because there are many types of logistics regression, this regression, that regression. We are just using fit model under this statistics regression, fit regression model. Only one option. There are many regression, nonlinear, you can say orthogonal, partial least, binary, ordinary, many logistics. Because if you will get these concepts, you can learn everything automatically. And our, four questions will also be depend on, the same explanation. Now, if you don't have any, thing, let me explain you the module number 4. Is it fine? Okay, thank you.
I had a question. The PowerPoints that you were showing look different than the ones posted. Are you going to post that one?
Yeah, later? You will get. Yeah, because this module starts from tomorrow. So, you are going to get that. Okay, no problem. Yes, now I'm going to go over module number 4, time series. So nowadays, you know what is happening, COVID-19. Now my question is to all of you, what is your assumption? What is your prediction that in next 365 days, what would be the, how many people will be infected by COVID-19, or how many people will be recovered by COVID-19? What do you think? Any guess? Okay, I can give you this answer that you can also plan, because I think I'm going to put this in discussion of module 4, so that you can think, you can use, because a lot of data is available across every website, that this is the number increasing country-wise, county-wise, or state-wise, everywhere across the world. And now you can use the simple time series analysis in order to do this. So let me go with a very simple. So let me clean all this. So basically, I have this data, and you will also get on your module. No, this is not. So this is the stock price, data of all the stocks, most important stocks. I got this data from Google Finance, I believe. So let's say I'm going to pick one stock, which is Amazon. Everyone is familiar with Amazon. How quickly is it? It is growing. So this is the, if you see that the stock, the data is from 2006 and it is up to 2017. So it is almost 12 years of data that we have. Stock prices data we have here in which is almost 3,000 plus, because 1 year is almost 365 days, and out of which few months holidays and this and that, and the stock market doesn't work. And so I'm just going to copy this data. And let me put in my Minitab. So you can see my data. And this data, for example, let's say very first day. On this day, the stock opens of Amazon in $47.47. Highest value on that day, 47.85. Lowest value on that day, this much. Close is this much. Similarly, every day till it is last day, which is 29 December 2000, and it was 11,000. Now I have a question. I have $10,000 in my pocket. $10,000, and I would like to invest. In which stock I can invest so that I can get the maximum return? Let me see. Let me see if I'm going to choose this Amazon. So $10,000 divided by what is the price of a stock today on last day? 1100. I'm just choosing the highest value. So 1184. How many stocks I can buy that day? I mean, I want to invest 8.5, roughly I can say. So I'm going to have 8.5 stocks of Amazon. I have this, you know, I need this investment for 3 years. After that, I need money. So 3 years, how, you know, or 1 year or 3 year, or let's say, what would be my return on investment? So let me go and solve this problem. I go under STAT. Under STAT, we have time series. You know what is the difference between time series data and cross-sectional? So this is time series data. Here I go in time series plot. Here we have simple. I go and I select high value. Here under time and scale, this option has to be, stamp has to be selected. And what is the stamp value? I am going to insert date. Okay, this is the only option when you are going to select. Now using this, what you can get? You can get the graph that shows the progress of Amazon stock. It is starting, it is, what kind of graph is this? I believe this is exponential graph. Because, you know, here it is starting slowly and keep growing like skyrocketing. So this is fine. Now next thing. So this is the one. Now I go under STAT, I go under time series. Trend analysis is the option. I'm going to use trend analysis. I'm going to select high. Now this is the most important option that you have to choose while doing trend analysis. Linear, quadratic, exponential, S-curve. How you can select which is the best one? So I know this is exponential. For how many days I need for 1,000 days investment or number of forecast, I need 1,000 days. So 1,000 days is almost 3 years, isn't it? Or less than or more than, you know, so let me put only 900 days, which is like 3 years. Okay. So this is okay. So since we have this data up to 319 days, 3,019 observations are there. Now let's say here, this is the equation of fitted equation, YT equal to this. Now, these are the accuracy measures. Now let me go on the. So basically this is the value you can predict, you are predicting, you are. So 3,020 days, the forecasted value would be like this. 360 days would be like this. And if you go all the way at the end of the day, you want to have this for 900 days. What is the value at the end of 900 days? So 3,919. At that time, the stock price will be 2,838. So let me do my simple calculation. So I have 8.44 stocks, and now what is the price of the stock? 2,838.35. This is the value that we got. So how much you got? You invested $10,000. Now you have almost $24,000. So in 3 years, $10,000 becomes $24,000 if you have invested in Amazon stocks. Similarly, in assignment, you are going to see which are the five, you are going to select five stocks and you are going to choose which is the right option for you to invest, where you can get the maximum return. So this is the simple I'm explaining about assignment. Let me go more conceptual things. So let's look into this. Here you can see this is the actual line is here, fit line is here, and forecasted line. So you can see this is the way the Amazon is going, it would be going like this based on these 3000 points. What are these values? These are the accuracy measures values, MAP, MAD, MSD. What is the meaning of this? This meaning, if this is your actual line and this is your, let's say, forecasted line, these are based on the difference of these. So actual and forecasted and based on that. So narrow, smaller is the difference between actual and forecasted, means your forecasted or trend analysis is the lower is the value of these items, MAP, MAD, MSD. So always look, you have four options where you have the least or minimum. So let me go one by one for all of them. So this is you can simply understand these are the accuracy measure, how accurate is your prediction or forecast or, time series analysis. Let me go the second option. State, time series, trend analysis. So earlier we did exponential. Let me do the quadratic. Okay, let me do the quadratic, and I'm not changing anything. So exactly the same value. Look into the quadratic fit. Yeah, this is also here. You can see that the exponential was exactly it doesn't have much gap, much deviation from actual and fit, but this is showing more deviation from. So therefore, you can see these parameters or these accuracy measures are higher. Now let me show the third option: stat, time series, trend analysis. And I'm going to choose the linear. And let's look into the linear model. Here you can see the MAP, MAD, MSD are much higher. And you can see the difference between actual and fit is widening. You can see this is going up and this is going here. Now let me do the fourth option. Stat and time series. And trend analysis and S-curve. And you can see here, this is going in this direction and this is going in this direction. And you can see the difference between actual and forecasted. So here MAP, SD, they are also higher. Where you get the least, which is the best fit, you can simply understand this is your best fit. And this is how you can do trial and error, means you try all four and then you can find which is the best trend. So this is the first thing. And yeah. So now let me go. There are a couple of other concepts. So you can do. Now, there are other methods are there in forecasting. One is STAT, time series, moving average method, single exponential smoothing, double exponential smoothing, you know, different autocorrelation and ARIMA. They are, you know, nowadays, if you have a small amount of data, let's say moving average, what is the moving average? Moving average, let's say these are the three items. If I put three moving average or five, let's say this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Average of these five values will be the next forecasting. Means if I am going to use moving average, what is the, so let me do the same thing here. And I'm going to do high again. Moving average length, I'm doing for 5. Center moving average, generate forecast, let me do for 100 points. 100. Now look into that. So this is the situation. By the end of, you know, high, it was $1,184. High was $1,184. Now here, forecasted values is, what is the average value of previous 5 days? So this is the previous 5 days. The average would be this. And it will remain same for the entire, you know, this forecast is same for next 100 days. Therefore, this is for a small values. This is important, but you know, this can be used. However, if you have large data, large amount of data, these are having their own limitations, because following all values will be based on previous 5 values, and they will be the average, and they will be. Now let me go with another one, which is called time series and single exponential variable. Let me see, high use 0.2, or you can find, you know, generate forecast for again 100. So this is constant, that, and here you can see this is forecast of all these values, and it is remain same. Therefore, trend analysis is the most important thing. Now there are one or two most important concepts about index in this chapter. So let me open the slides of this. Where's module? So basically, moving average, exponential smoothing, these are the very values, but you can do. Index number, you know, is another important thing. So I think I covered all the things here that is there. So I can show you trend, cycle, seasonal, irregular. These are the equations of different trend. So for example, exponential trend, AEBT or quadratic, this is the equation. This is which you can get directly from the Minitab. So let me show you one thing, which is right here. So time series plot, this is time series. Here you can see this is your, you know, and on the top you can see the equation. So this is the equation of trend analysis, or this. Similarly, you can see this is the trend analysis of, this is the equation of trend analysis. This is another one. This is another one. So basically, this comes directly from Minitab. exponential slope, R square, you can also do the regression based on this. How you can do? Let me show you. So, calculate stat regression. So, basically high equal to this and this state. R square is 79, this. You can also do this. However, that is because you plot that line between. So let's say this is your high value. This is your time and you plot the line like this. So based on this, the regression model can also be constructed. Now, the last concept in this is, so these are the, you know, five measure of fit, which is, you know, MAP, MAD, MSD. So you can see, you know, simple thing. The smallest the value of these things are better the fit. So let me go with the last thing, which is index number. So you know the index number is everywhere nowadays. For example, happiness index, which is the happiness index of the countries, which is the happiest country in the world. And that is indexed. Which is the highly competitive country, that there is an index. And all the stock markets they have, or all the financial things they have, the indexed. So Standard and Poor, or Dow Jones, or Nikkei, or London Stock Exchange, or think about any stock exchange, they have the index that you say stock falls, stocks up. What is that? So basically, let me go and explain about Dow Jones index, and then you can. So basically, this is called relative index. That means here current period equal to 100 multiplied by, you know, by one, which is base value, and by t, which is as of value, means today's values. Convert a time series by one into relative index, divided each data value by data value by one in a base period and multiply by 100. So basically, this is a base value, this is current value, and then we have a weighted index. So Dow Jones is a weighted index. So let me see. Let me show you the Dow Jones. Dow Jones. So this is Dow Jones Industrial Average, or, you know, here you can see index weighted. Can you see 3M has 4.35%. American Express has 2%. How many, first of all, let me see how many are there in Dow Jones. This Dow Jones is based on 30 companies or 30, you know, companies average, weighted average, not average. It's a weighted average because, you know, who is having highest weightage? Apple is 8% in 100, you know, in this weight. Similarly, you will see Google might have also, IBM, Intel, IBM is also. Home Depot has 6.17. Does it have Google? Walmart has 3.44. I don't see. The Dow Jones has Google. Exxon Mobil, Cisco. No, Google is not there. So basically, this is the weight. And how do they do? So when the Dow Jones, when the first thing by one is the base value, and the current value of the, you know, stock prices, let me simply calculate, not going using this. So let's see. So let's say I'm going to calculate some index. And let's say I assign bid for 8 point or 40%. So I'll put 40% for 0.40 and then into, let's say, when I started Dow Jones, what is the base price or what is the base price from where it, I started calculated 3M or anything. So the base price is, let's say, $100 at that time when, you know, it was incorporated in Dow. And today is the like 2000. Plus, let's say another thing is 40%. And it is 100 into, at that time it was like, you know, 200 when it was base price it started. And today is like 2000. The third thing is, let's say the third one is 20%. 100 into, let's say again, you know, that was, let's say 50 and now it's 500. I'm just doing for a small calculus. And if you compute or calculate all the things, you will get to know. So this 100, 2000 multiplies by 40, which is 800. Plus, this is 2, and this is 1,400 plus. So this come 2 plus 500, 1,000, and 20%, 200. So simple calculation, 8, 4, 12, plus 2, 1,400. This index value is 1,400. So the index value changes every day because the stock price or stock value changes of every company every day. And this basis will remain same because it was the very first value. So this is how, you know, all the stock exchange, this index are calculated. We don't have option in Minitab, and but you can do in Excel, you can do here. You also compute based, if you have the data, you can just feed in calculator. You can do the calculation, you assign the weight, and you can get the index if you have the base price. So this is what I wanted to cover about module 3 and module 4. And next week I will cover module 5 and module 6. So if you have any question, please let me know. If no, this recording will be posted tonight and you will get the slides, you will get everything, and you will get the reply of your questions if you will have from Monday onwards. Tomorrow, probably you will not get the reply because I will not have the access of the computer. So, any question, anything? Otherwise, I would like to say have a nice weekend. Most welcome. Most welcome. Thank you, John. Thank you, Mary. Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Bye-bye. So I'm ending this meeting and we'll share the recorded one.